But so I read about the labor, when I got interested in labor history, as I suppose as a result of my working in a shipyard, sort of hard, dirty work, working out on the ways where the right on the river were, and very cold in the winter time where the wind blew in, and very sort of dirty, smelly work. This was industrial work, and I realized that this is what people have been doing for generations, for long, long hours, and getting very, very little pay for it. And that interested me in the history of the labor movement, and I read about the labor struggles that people went through, and I read about the role that radicals had played, like the IWW, the Industrial Workers of the World. They were anarchists, they call themselves anarchist syndicalists because they're sort of union people who are anarchists, they were the ones who helped organize the strike of textile workers in Lawrence, Massachusetts in 1912, a lot of them women, and a strike that was, not too many strikes were at that time, successful after they went through a lot of hardships. And those anarchists who were involved in the strike, you know, did tremendously important work in organizing those people. In 1930s, I think the same thing happened in so many industries. My own experience in working in a shipyard was that talking to people who worked with me, that if you stood up for the things that people wanted, that even though they thought you might be a communist or a radical because of the way you were talking, that didn't matter so much, you know, if you were with them for bettering their working conditions. I could understand why the communists were effective in the 30s in organizing the CIO, because people are anti-communist when there's nothing else happening, but if something's happening that moves them, that they're concerned about their lives, and the communists are there helping them, forget about it. Who cares what they are, you see? When I was involved in the late 50s, early 60s, when I changed my class, you might say, I'm using Marxian language, right? Changed my class from the working class to the professorial class. You know, I went to school under the GI Bill of Rights, got my PhD at Columbia, went down to teach at Spelman College in Atlanta, and became involved in the civil rights movement. And it was interesting to me that the civil rights movement was called communist. And I realized then that whenever anything went on that was outside the pale, any struggle that went on that people did to better their lives, it was always called communist. Sometimes there was some truth to it. There were a few communists involved. There never were a lot of communists involved because there just never were that many communists in the country. You know, even when the communists were in the CIO, they were just a handful of people, but most of the people were just working people, right? But the label communist was attached to the whole CIO. In the civil rights movement, you could hardly find a communist. If I went looking for a communist in the civil rights movement, I would have a hard time finding one. Martin Luther King was called a communist. Why? A picture of him was taken at Highlander Folk School, which was they called it communist. It was a school and a little gathering place, a community center in Tennessee where labor organizers and blacks and whites in the segregated South could get together. And Martin Luther King, a lot of black people who later become involved in the civil rights movement, went to Highlander Folk School, attended workshops and sessions and classes. That always looks communist. Just like, I remember I was quoting that congressman from Illinois who said, if you have a mobile library service in rural areas, this will increase communism because people will be educated. As soon as they see people going to classes, they think, oh, well. But Highlander Folk School was that kind of place. King went there, Rosa Parks went there, Ella Baker went there, Andrew Young went there, pictures were taken. Ah, I see a communist in the picture, you see. It was weird. What was interesting was that, it wouldn't have mattered if there were a few communists or not in the civil rights movement. The important in the civil rights movement, like all of these movements, then there were movements that directed against some terrible evil that was going on, whether the evil was the 12-hour day in one instance or the evil was racial segregation in another. And then the people who gathered around these movements were always called communists. And so the sit-inners were called, You know, Truman, Harry Truman said that, you know, communism is behind it and so on. And other people said the same thing. But it was interesting to me that none of these accusations meant anything to the black people who were involved in the movement. Here they are, the very people who are segregating them and discriminating against them and beating them and killing them when they try to go to register to vote are calling them communists if they try to organize against them. So they're not going to become suddenly anti-communist. But what I learned was that the word communist is used. It's a device. It's used by the people who run things and control things and own things and want to keep things as they are. It's used as a way of getting people's minds off what the problem is. And making them, instead of looking at the people who are oppressing them, instead of looking at racial segregation or the employers of the big corporations or the government sending people to war, they would look around for communists, scapegoats, really, scapegoats. Like people would look for Jews or people would look for Catholics at different periods in history, infidels, heretics, a wonderful way of overcoming the natural desire of people to organize and struggle. And they discovered, you know, it's easier than using the police to beat down everybody. Use the word communist and you'll confuse people. And you'll make them stop what they're doing, say, hey, are there communists behind this and what does this mean? So it made me very skeptical and suspicious whenever I saw the word communist attached to anything. It made me want to look closer. What's going on here? And what is interesting to me in thinking now about our present time, you know, post-McCarthyism, you know, a lot of people think of McCarthyism in the 50s as the period of anti-communism, but of course, anti-communism, anti-radicalism has been with us for a very long time. And before the McCarthy period, after the McCarthy period. But what's interesting to me is I believe that it's no longer as successful as it used to be. I think people have a lot of common sense. People aren't born anti-communist, you don't think that. You learn it, just like people aren't born racist. You have to learn to be a racist. You have to learn to be. And I think people have learned, maybe through the civil rights movement, the Vietnam War, maybe they've learned through the overuse of the word communist, communist here, communist there, they've learned to be suspicious. You know, when we use communism to describe what's happening in Guatemala, well, people learn, and then we stop communism in Guatemala, and then you have a dictatorship in Guatemala, not democracy. I think that makes people suspicious. I think there's a lot of learning that has taken place in the last 20 years about this use of the word communism. Went into Vietnam to stop communism, and we see the disastrous results. And I think that in this country, something interesting happened, you know, the Hollywood 10, the Blacklist, and so on. One by one, these people reappeared. Suddenly, their names reappeared on the screen. Suddenly, they were writing movies again. Now they have Academy Award gatherings at which these formerly blacklisted people are up there at the microphone, at the accepting awards and so on. I think Americans are much more resistant to the charges of anti-communism than they used to be. I think that's a very healthy thing, because it means now it'll be easier to simply examine things on their merits, call shots as you see them, tell the truth about things, and not be befogged by, are there communists around? Where are they? Are they responsible? No, let's see who's for me, who's for the children, who's against war, and so on. And let's decide things rationally on their merits. I think that kind of common sense is increasing in the United States. That's a hopeful sign.
And yet at the same time, George Bush levied a criticism of Congress as being carried. He was elected by such a wide.
Well, you know, if we pay too much attention to elections, here's where radicals have something to say to us, you see. Because the non-radicals, the Democrats and Republicans, say, elections, elections, this is democracy. What is democratic about an election in which most people have very little to say about who the candidates are? Most people wake up and read the newspapers and they say, Bush is the Republican candidate, and Dukakis is the Democratic candidate, and I don't like either one of them. Here we have a choice. 50% of the people did not vote. Bush won the election with 27% of the voting population. 27%. The election is not a mandate. People aren't. Elections tell us very little about where people are. The election of Bush is the most unenthusiastic expression of people. People did not have a real choice. If Jesse Jackson had been on the ticket, speaking for racial equality, speaking for economic equality, speaking against our foreign policy, against the spending of huge amounts of money on the arms budget while letting the cities fester. If we'd had somebody like that, then we would have had a choice. Had no choice. So the election of Bush to me is insignificant. The radical view makes a lot of sense, and that is voting is not the highest expression of a citizen in a democracy. Voting is something you do once in 4 years, and you do it in a pitiful choice between very often terrible candidates. That's not what democracy is. People organizing, doing, protesting, acting, speaking up for themselves every day on the job, in their community, organizing movements, joining organizations, women's organizations, anti-war organizations, the civil rights movement, the anti-war movement, the women's movement, all of these movements and all these little groups now around the country, groups simply fighting in their neighborhoods for clean air, against the pollution, against toxic waste, to stop a nuclear plant which might kill everybody. All these little groups, there are thousands of them around the country, you see. Now that's democracy. That's real democracy. Voting is a pitiful expression of democracy.
Maybe you could sum up, because another one of these myths that we want to explode is that communism is somehow equated with the violent overthrow of the government. And if you could speak to how the history of American communism is connected with the history of civil disobedience in this country.
Well, you know, sure, communists are always, accused of the violent overthrow of the government, and it's really funny because there have been violent overthrows of the government all through history, most of them done not by communists. There have been some violent overthrows by communists. I might say that the Russian Revolution was a revolution in which about 100 people got killed. The American Revolution was a revolution in which tens of thousands of people got, you know. So the violent revolution is not something that's peculiar to communists. It's a fact of revolution everywhere. But in fact, Marx himself, although they always quoting Marx because he used the words like force and violence and so on, you can always quote people. And Marx believed that probably in some cases you would need a violent overthrow of the government, but he also thought that in some cases, he pointed to England where there was, or maybe even Germany where you could vote, where there were parliaments, where you had more liberties, that you might actually get to do away with capitalism without a violent revolution. Communists in this country have certainly not been very violent. They've been remarkably conservative and cautious. Most of the social movements in this country have not been violent. The labor movement has been actually remarkably nonviolent. What do the labor movements do? They picket. That's what they do. You know, they picket. And sometimes they go as far as trying to stop strike breakers from entering the plant. That's as far as they can get. They don't generally kill people or beat people the way police do when they attack picket lines or workers. People in the civil rights movement were not violent. That was strictly, even philosophically, deliberately a nonviolent movement. Anti-war movement, which is now trying to paint the anti-war movement as this group of drug-crazed, rock and roll-crazed kids, you know, with anti-war movement, of course, was a very nonviolent movement directed against enormous violence. The greatest violence in history has not been committed by movements. It's been committed by governments. People should remember that. The greatest violence committed by governments. And movements have, in general, been remarkably nonviolent. You know, a few fringe, you know, elements in movements have engaged in violence, but that's all. So you know, we're going to have to have a world in which the kind of violence we've seen is done away with, and the radical groups, I think, are playing an important part in helping to bring about such a world.
The only last question I would ask you is just in terms of being a teacher, I mean, do you recall any specific incident of undermining somebody's preconceptions about communism or belief, or any particular encounter unique to teaching? Because we're asking people from their experiences how they've encountered anti-communism. I was wondering, as a teacher, either faculty or students.
Well, there's a sort of a simple thing that can happen in the classroom, and which has happened with me too. And as you ask students, you know, how many people are for communism? Hardly anybody will raise their hand unless they're an FBI agent. But how many people here are against communism? You know, a lot of people against communism. Well, how many people here believe in a more equal distribution of wealth? A majority of people in the class will say we need a more equal distribution of wealth. How many people here believe we really don't need national boundaries, that we should have an international society in which people can move freely across borders and so on? Most people will raise their hands. Now, how many people believe that we should sort of be cooperative in the way we work and the way things are owned together, and people should have a say in industry, that the economy should be democratic, not only the voting for president and so on. So most people say, that's right, yes. What I'm trying to say is, of course, the classroom is a good place to get beyond slogans, either for communists or against communists, or public opinion polls, which are very bad because they give people simplistic questions and they get simplistic answers. The classroom is a good place to get beyond that and to start exploring the complexities of these words, you know. Sure, I'm against secret police and dictatorships and Stalinism and imperialism and sending troops into Hungary, but I'm for a world which might realize that original dream of socialists and anarchists and communists, which we badly need.
Have you ever been accused of being a communist?
Oh, lots. you know, sure, during the Vietnam War. Oh, you're against the Vietnam War. Oh, you must be a communist. Are you a communist, you know? Man, you mean you think because I think that here is a country which, yes, it seems that revolution in Vietnam seems to be led by communists. And because I think that we should not send an army over there to kill all those Vietnamese peasants, most of whom are not communists, and kill some of our own and kill a lot of them because we want our government in there instead of their government, that make me a communist? It seems to me what I'm suggesting is really common sense to save lives. And I was called a communist by this group, Accuracy in Academia, or a Marxist. Well, sometimes those two things are used together, a Marxist or a communist. I was called a Marxist. And then I was asked when Accuracy in Academia is this outfit, this mysterious outfit, which came and went in the press. You know, they were looking for Marxists everywhere in the classroom, worried that Marxist teachers were indoctrinating students. Well, all teachers have viewpoints, and radical teachers, conservative teachers, even teachers who don't call themselves anything, they all have viewpoints. And when I'm asked, are you a Marxist? I say, sort of. A little. Some of the ideas of Marx are very good, but I don't know what you mean. Let's talk about it. Let's explain it. Do you mean am I for a world society and for the end of war? Absolutely. Am I against the profit motive, corporate profit as driving production and determining who gets what and what is built, determining that you should build skyscrapers for insurance companies instead of homes for low-income people? Am I against that? Absolutely, you know. And so, you know, let's take the word apart. And so, yeah, I've been accused of that. But when I'm accused of that, I try to get beyond yes or no answers and say, let's talk about real things, what we're for, what we're against.
Has it had any personal consequences for you?
We out of time?
Yeah. We have got 2 minutes.
Okay. Too rigid to say if there's any personal consequences or sacrifices or of these accusations.
The personal consequences have not been as a result of me being called a communist, I suppose. Maybe, although I don't know what was in people's minds, but I was fired from my first teaching job because I was involved with a student movement in Atlanta, you see. And people are, most of the punishment is, although they may use the word communist or Marxist, most of the punishment is simply against people who are active in movements, and in that sense. But I've been lucky, you see. I've gone to jail a number of times for being in anti-war demonstrations or anti-arms race demonstrations and so on. But I've been lucky. I've survived, but I know a lot of people have not been lucky. A lot of people have lost their jobs, and a lot of people have suffered as a result of this word communist thrown at them to obscure what is going on in the world. Yeah.
Great, thank you.
Okay.